Tell us maybe a little bit about the central...
Yes, I'm happy to point out some details. Yes. There's always a lot of information in an opening like that. Mm-hmm. And these things are also designed to be studied for a long time and to a bit like a labyrinth, so you can discover new things. Mm. The longer you look, the more meaning and the more references you discover. So it's quite different from the way modern people look.
Yeah,
they want to look and absorb the essence of the information right away. Mm-hmm. So the centerpiece of this opening is obviously the crucifixion, but as we said, there are many little details concealed in it. So before we examined this main miniature in some detail, let me just point out that among all the cute flowers and little insects, you have this angel with the crown of thorns.
Right, of course, yes,
So that is changes the value and the symbolism quite a bit. And while we're at it, here again we have a smaller miniature. This is Christ. Not coming out of a bath,
yes, he looks as like one he's might out of a bath,
think.
Right.
He's rising from his tomb, and around him you see all the instruments of the Passion. Since this here is the column on which he was flagellated.
I see, yes.
Here you see the lance that pierced him right after he dies, the nails of the cross, and so forth. Another little detail here is this figure. This is,
who is
a representation of the donor. And he
so that's
is
the abbot?
Yes.
Yes, all right.
The abbot of Park, and with his abbey in the background. Beautifully depicted in quite a realistic way. And he holds this heart transfixed
with arrows,
two arrows that you've just observed. One could have quite a long discussion whether that's his heart that is pierced by remorse or whether he is in pain with Jesus or whether it's the heart of Mary in pain seeing her son being crucified. But that's the beauty of this visual language.
That it
can mean all of these things. And we are invited as onlookers or readers to create our own meaning, and of course, if you are believing Catholic, to also see this man as an example for yourself, just as we should see Christ or Mary as examples for our own way of life.
So I see that the abbot is in blue, and is that Mary then? Is she in blue as well? They're sort of linking the two colors, are they?
Yes, now of course Mary is almost always blue. We know that blue was a very special, very precious color, so she wears very beautiful garments, but it's also very typical of Mary. So blue is not a liturgical color. So it may well be that this is to indicate some special connection or veneration that he had for Mary. Now let's look a little bit at the people here before we move on. So we have here Mary under the cross, and then that would be St. John, the evangelist, to whom Christ on the cross says, basically,
look after
this is
Mary.
This is your mother, and to Mary says, this is your son, so he basically passes the stewardship from himself to John, he passes it on to him, and also she becomes his substitute mother, but also of course he's supposed to look after her in her coming old age. And of course, St. John has a very special relationship with Jesus too, because he always, when in the Gospel, he speaks of himself as the disciple whom Jesus loved. Theologically speaking, it's because he was the most chaste of the apostles, just like he is Jesus himself.
Interesting, yeah.
So they are both also virgins.
Right, interesting.
And here, in a little bit of time warp, I believe we see the three Marys, who actually are known from a little later in the story. they are the three women that go on Easter morning
to
the tomb and discover that it's empty. Mm-hmm. But to sort of conflate these things in one image is, of course, also very typical of like medieval iconography, and basically allows you to say more in one single.
They're definitely wearing Flemish or headdresses, aren't they?
Yes. Well, some more, some less.
Yeah.
The iconography of Mary is pretty standard at that time already, but indeed, because these are not so much, they're also saintly, but they're, I mean, Mary, modest Mary Magdalene, a form of prostitute.
Exactly.
So they indeed wear the outfits. Mm-hmm. Or some outfits that one could have seen at that time, yes. And that's also, of course, very common to see the scenes of the people represented in contemporary clothing. It's not because people didn't know that people might have worn different things at the time of Jesus, but to bring it into their reality.
Yes, yes, of course. So now tell us about some of these figures. Who was that, do you think, with this tonsured monk down here?
Yeah, that is probably, could be Saint Norbert.
It's
some clearly a cleric, to judge by the hair style. Can't quite say, it's not specifically identified.
And that's the abbot again, is that right?
No, that is might be Saint Augustine, because that would make some sense, because they have the rule of Saint Augustine, who was also a bishop, and of course is a major saint and church father, and then Saint Norbert, the founder of the order, took Augustine as his model, but again the hierarchy is very clear. He is in the middle rank, lower rank, even lower.
I see,
But still visible. Yeah. And of course Christ on top of each of everything. We should maybe end with just a look at the complex of the abbey.
Yes.
Which, from for all we know, is a fairly realistic representation of the abbey as it was, and to some extent still is.
Is that right? You can still see it.
You
that
can
way
see
today.
It's not exactly like it, but it's very similar. This is also a very common thing to bring all these scenes of the crucifixion into a palpable reality for people at the time. And it's also, of course, a way to indicate who this person is. And you see also how this is then blended with the events of the crucifixion, because here you see the storm brewing,
as described
in the Bible, and the wind is flowing.
Of course,
Is blowing, so you see how his loincloth is all fluttering.
Yeah.
So it's probably precisely 3 p.m.
Yes, exactly.
When the earth begins
Friday,
to tremble.
On Good Friday, yes, indeed.
Yes. And here one final reminder of mortality in general is the skull and the bone.
Well, it is lovely.